had a good country band and I played the fiddle. Buddy played the guitar and he used to play the banjo, son. We harmonized like Bill Monroe and the bluegrass boys. Bob wore my hat and played the flat top with his thumb. We played them joints and had a lot of fun with the women. We swigged on bootleg beer and played licks in the sun. We got our picture in the paper with her eyes covered up. They said our music made the kids do sin. Stuck we were crazy back then, though we sure had lots of fun. But then Elvis came along and nobody just loved him. But I couldn't tell where rock and roll was coming from. But I stuck around cause someone had to play like Scotty. Joe B played the bass and J.I. played the drum. But I grew up and had to go out and make a living. I picked a Slim Whitman tour and I wound up on the road. And them good old boys began to make some noise around Texas. And they got hot as a pistol, a-picking that rock and roll. But that'll be the day came much too soon for Buddy. He was a good old boy and he had a good Christian soul. He never knocked nobody down in his life. He loved us all and he treated us right. And you know the levee ain't dry and the music didn't die. 'Cause Buddy Holly lives every time we play rock and roll.
That's Sonny Curtis singing about his old friend Buddy Holly. Sonny wrote the song after he'd been to see a movie called The Buddy Holly Story, which may have been a lot of laughs, but it was hardly the true story. So Sonny wrote the song to try and put the record straight. I've always loved Buddy's music, and he's been a big influence on me. So I wanted to make a film that would allow his family and friends to share their memories of him with us. So here it is. It's my tribute to Buddy, the real Buddy Holly story. Hope you enjoy it.
Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal, yes, I need you, Peggy Sue.
I love you, Peggy Sue. Oh, yes, I love so very true. Oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue.
Well, I love you, gal, I want you, Peggy Sue.
Ask you a question. How old are all of you fellas?
Well, there's 218, 120, and I'm 21.
Where do you come from? Lubbock, Texas?
Lubbock, Texas, yes.
You go to school down there?
Well, we did until we got out of high school, finally.
Right after high school, you started playing together?
Yes, sir, that's right.
Your big hit right from the start, or has it been sort of a long...
Well, we've had a few rough times, I guess you say, but we've been real lucky getting it this quick.
Well, Texas, nice to have you up here.
Thank
Let's
you,
have a very nice hand for these Texas wrestlers.
Words were made for lovers in the gloaming. The sweetest days were the days that used to be. The saddest words I ever heard were words of heartache. When you said, sweetheart, remember me. Remember me when the candlelights are gleaming. Remember me at the close of a long, long day. It'll be so sweet when all alone I'm dreaming. Just to know you still remember me.
I guess Buddy got most of his musical talent from mother's side of the family. My father was loved music. He couldn't carry a tune in a bag, but he would insist on us playing. And most of the songs that we sang, of course, were Baptist songs and all old, golden oldies, we called them. And they still use them at the Baptist church that we go to.
They had an amateur contest, and Mother and Dad always wanted us to take Buddy because he was so cute, you know. And he was, he had a little violin, but he couldn't play it and just mess us up, we thought. But anyway, we took him out, and he did sing a song, and I think that might have been what caused us to win the contest. The name of it was, Have You Ever Gone Sailing Down the River of Memories? And it's an old song, but he sang it so cute. But whenever we was playing, well, he'd fiddle right along with me, and Travis was playing the accordion. But we had grease on his bow, so you couldn't hear him. And we thought we was playing a good trick on him. He didn't ever know the difference at that time.
Well, initially, as I remember it, Mother and Dad gave him violin lessons, which he didn't care for at all. And later on, they got him a steel guitar. And that was about the age of 11, I believe. And he said, no, I don't want a guitar like that. I want one like Travis has got. So he would borrow mine.
Of me, darling, while we're many miles apart. Oh, please, please do to me, my darling, for you are the flower of my heart.
Where y'all from? Where's your hometown?
Lubbock, Texas.
Well, how far is that from a place like Dallas or Crystal City? I mean, Texas is big, man.
Well, our hometown, Lubbock, is 280 miles straight west of Dallas.
Would you like to go back there?
Sure would.
What's the weather like this time of year down there?
Oh, it's not quite this cool.
It's not.
And it's a little bit drier.
For I can live while we're apart.
We met when we were about 12 years old, I guess. We started playing together at that time. We were just kind of learning to play. He was playing guitar, and he fooled around with a mandolin some and with a banjo some. We were doing basically country kind of things then. Most of the time we were working at one thing or another. Buddy's father was a carpenter, and we worked as carpenters, helpers, and roofing houses, and we worked mainly to make enough money and get together enough money so that we could go to a studio and put down some of the things that we were doing.
Tonight I'm so blue, I'm thinking of you. I got the Scott to get you near me.
Buddy and Bob soon became Lubbock's most popular young act. They had their own business cards and a manager. High Pockets Duncan was a local DJ who looked after the boys and got them gigs at the Roller Rink and Lubbock's Cotton Club, supporting the many country and rock stars who came through town. It was now, too, that Buddy was joined by another teenager making his name in the clubs, Sonny Curtis.
I met Buddy when I was about a sophomore in high school, and Buddy was playing with Bob Montgomery, and they had a little group together, and Buddy played the banjo, like a four-string banjo at the time. And Bob was playing a guitar. And I guess it's kind of like playing cowboys and Indians, you know. They were playing bluegrass music, and Buddy was being Earl Scruggs, and Bob was being Lester Flatt.
So what sort of things were they playing?
Well, they were playing, if I can illustrate, I don't do too much bluegrass anymore. It's like standing on a corner with a low-down blues, a great big hole in the bottom of your shoes. Honey, let me be your softy dog. Let me be your softy dog, or I ain't gonna be your man at all. Honey, let me be your softy dog. Look at your woman, I know you. Run down the stocking and a worn-out shoe. Honey, let me be your softy dog. Let me be your salty dog, or I ain't gonna be your man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog.
The summer we got out of school, we started really working around playing nightclubs. And as I said before, we played car lots and grocery store parking lots. And they'd have remote broadcasts from a radio station. They'd send a crew out and we'd be on the air, you know, and man, we'd draw a big crowd. After we started picking, people hear us on the radio and they'd drive over. And we played in nightclubs when we were real young. It was really against the law, but for some reason or other, we got away with it.
Actually, I just played Stranger Thought and asking him to make a
performance
champion
for 1958. Let's bring the crickets on, the fellas who work with you.
Okie dokie. Well, the first one here is Jerry Allison.
Jerry, nice to see you.
And he's the drummer for the Crickets.
Right up here on the right was 16th and J Club. I guess probably the first place I ever played with Buddy Holly. Ooh, it's a vacant lot now. That's probably an improvement from the 16th and J Club, but it was a real joint. We played there. I played with Cal Wayne and Riverside Ranch Hands at the time when Buddy used to come and sit in with us and play like 40 cups of coffee and Bill Haley tunes. This is Lubbock High up here on the left. And Buddy graduated from there in 1955, and I graduated in 1956. But look, it's even ivy covered now, part of it. He didn't really change that much from the time I knew him in junior high school. We wore real, more inconspicuous type glasses, like with the wire rims, as opposed to, like saying, okay, I wear glasses, and here they are. And I think when he finally decided he looked good with glasses on, it was a. But he always looked pretty well the same. Always had curly hair and always real neat dresser. Like he always liked his Levi's creased real nice and iron starched shirts. And it was just a neat.
So he was a perfectionist, as evidenced by the tooling on his leather guitar case and. Other hobbies, I think he liked drafting, architectural drafting, and he worked a while during his high school days at one steel plant out here. Actually, at one time, I think he was going to make that his career, but music took priority over that, so that dropped to the wayside.
I'd say when he was 16 or 17, he got real interested in it, and he didn't dream that he could make his living at it that early, but he would like to. That was by far the overweighing desire of his life for music. And we thought he was good. And after he did get good, we really thought he was good, but we didn't think that there'd be a chance that he'd ever make it, you know. Not from here.
Well, my old car's rolling down the line. Thoughts of my baby running through my mind. She's waiting for me. You gotta be on time. I gotta roll, 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 roll. I gotta roll, 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 roll. Well, the white marks flying on the road below. Man, I'm ready to fly. No, my baby's waiting. I can't go slow. I gotta roll, 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 roll. I gotta
We sort of hung out around radio stations. That was sort of seemed like some place to get a break. Yeah, this KRLB now, it used to be KDAV, where we used to come out and do the Sunday party. And then when we finally got some records cut, they played them, which was nice too.
We would sit out in Buddy's car late at night. They had a show out of Shreveport, Louisiana called Stan's Record Stores, Record Rack, or something like that. And he didn't come on till something like midnight. So I'd go up and spend the night with Buddy, and he and I would go out at midnight and sit in the car and listen to this guy out of Shreveport. And he played really good blues stuff, you know, like Lonnie Johnson, was the guy's name. Boy, he was terrific.
I won't be back until fall.
And a lot of black artists, you know. Seemed like Lead Belly was one. And we liked it a lot, and so that's probably where that blues influence came from.
Me and Buddy, he was working for me in the tile business, and we had a big tile job. Had to go to San Angelo to get a truckload of tile, and 18-wheeler, and I let him help me drive it down there. We sort of learned how together on the thing. Anyway, we got to San Angelo and went in this place to get a hamburger. It turned out to be more of a joint than anything else, but we stayed in there, and they had a black combo in there playing. And Buddy got to talking with them, and he knew their language, you know, and hanging around up there. And they said, "Hey, man, why don't you come up here and play us one?" And he said, "Well, I don't mind if I do." And, you know, he just dying to. He just had on his Levi's and his jeans. And anyway, as soon as he got that guitar, I would have swore it was a different instrument completely. Just the way you pressed down on it or something, he made a clean sound. It was just a dead little joint when we went in, and it was rocking before we left.
About seniors in high school, Elvis came through the country, man, and he just started, and he was brand new. And we all just fell in love with that style of music because, well, mainly because girls all liked it, you know. So that made us like it, too.
It was on a Sunday afternoon. It was at a show, and it was the first time we met Elvis. And we didn't know what he looked like. We had no pictures of him. So Buddy was there, and naturally, Elvis had had his first release, a 78 record. And Buddy wanted to see what he looked like, you know, as well as all of us. We didn't know what the guy looked like, you know. But we wanted to hear what this boy from Mississippi, or hear him and see him, you know, what he was like. And, of course, we did get to see him that day. Who else was on the show? Let's see, there was Johnny Cash. He was a young man at the time trying to get started. Buddy wasn't on that particular show because there were several more and really didn't have room for him, I guess is what what they said that day. Carl Perkins and his band was on the show. And of course, Elvis closed the show. And no one had ever seen him. I believe that was his first appearance. I'm sure about that. He only had two songs out, I believe, at that time. That's All Right, Mama and the Blue Moon of Kentucky. I know we would play it at the radio station because it was a bluegrass country type song. And the audience seemed to accept that, you know, because of the song.
We had a band very similar to Elvis. Buddy was Elvis, and I played like Scotty Moore. And we had a bass player, Don Guess, who could play slap bass, you know, that rhythmic slap-type bass is what we called it. He could play slap bass just like Bill Black. And, man, the next day when Elvis left town, when we were in business, man, we started booking out.
Well, if you see old Annie, better give her a lift. Cause Annie's been a-working on a midnight shift. If Annie puts her hair up on her head,
It wasn't long before they were noticed by the talent scouts and headed east. Booked to record his first sessions for Decca, but he drove the 1,000 miles to Nashville. Sonny Curtis went on the trip as Buddy's guitarist.
We were in Buddy Holly's 55 Oldsmobile, the old black and white Oldsmobile. And we were friends, actually, with Marty Robbins. That's his road manager was the one that was responsible for getting us our deal with Jim Denny. And we were just all real excited about seeing all the stars, and we knew that all we had to do was get a record deal, and that was, and then we just sat back and waited for the big time, you know. That was, we were convinced it was a big star from then on out. Of course, that wasn't the case. This is Music Row, and this is where our trip from Lubbock ended. It was right up here at Bradley's barn. This is the back of CBS offices. And right there at the top of that corner is the what remains of Bradley's barn. Yeah, a little curved bit of roof is the old Quonset hut where we recorded. Kind of like an army barracks.
Blue days, black nights, blue tears keep on falling for you, dear. Now you're gone. Blue days, black nights, my heart keeps on calling for you, dear. And you alone. Memories of you make me sorry. I gave you reason to doubt me, but now you're gone.
Blue days, black nights, I didn't realize that I'd miss you the way I do. But now, somehow, I know that I'll pay for the times that make you blue. Memories of you make me sorry. I gave you reasons to die.
I wrote the song because it was very blue days at that time, black nights. Just dark nights, didn't know where I was going. But after I got the song started, then I felt like it was for him. And I never showed it to anyone, but I wasn't in Lubbock at that time, but I did go back and I called Buddy, and he met me at the radio station, and out in the shade of the radio station, I learned him that song, and he said, I really like that. He said, I really like that song. So that's how that came about. Of course, later he came to Nashville to make the song, and he and I were pretty disappointed they wouldn't let him use drums because he was used to that, but they didn't know how to record drums at that particular time.
Two singles were released from the Decca sessions, but somehow things didn't quite work out. Buddy and J.I. kept on playing in Texas and began to record elsewhere. They were joined for a while by guitarist Nicky Sullivan and the third member of the Crickets, bassist Joe B. Malden.
When Buddy asked me to play with the group, he said, why don't you, you know, join up with us, man, and be, you know, the bass player with the group all the time. Said, big things are going to happen. And said, we're going to cut a record, and it's going to come out, and we're going to have a hit and all that. And I says, of course, I'd heard that before, you know. And I said, how long do you think it's going to take? And Buddy says, how long did it take Elvis? So, you know, I mean, right there was evident that Buddy was very confident in himself and what was going to happen with the group as a whole.
I lived here from the time I was about probably 12 years old, and we had our instruments set up in the back bed. My bedroom in the house was pretty big, and we set up our instruments there and rehearsed quite a bit. That's the house right over the brown shutter. We used to sit in that driveway there a lot and say, how in the world are we going to make it? Buddy and I had been to see a movie called The Searchers, and we were into playing a lot, like practicing almost every night then. We were sitting around just practicing. He was playing guitar and I was sitting playing the drums in my mom's house. And I'd never tried to write a song at the time. Holly was playing this, like had a tune in his head, and he said, hey, let's write a song. And I said, that'll be the day. He said, that's a good idea. And so he wrote it in about 30 minutes.
That'll Be the Day had been recorded by Norman Petty, the Crickets' new manager. Norman and his wife Vi had been recording stars themselves with their Norman Petty trio. They now ran a studio in Clovis, New Mexico, 100 miles from Lubbock.
About 90 miles on out here is Clovis. It's about 10 miles across the Texas border into New Mexico, and there's a time change at the border, like it's our. It's an hour earlier there, so if you like when the speed limits weren't so bad, and it's really a nice straight road, and you used to could leave here and get there before you left almost. It's like 100 miles. Everybody drove fast those days. I remember Joe B driving faster than anybody. I can't remember the first time, but anyway. I remember Joe B sitting there one day with like one hand on the wheel like that and one hand on the seat driving along talking, and he's going like 135 miles an hour, and he's in his 58 Bonneville Pontiac. And that would scare me stiff these days, but didn't I thought, oh, look at Joe B, he's going 135. And didn't worry me a bit then.
You left me here all alone. Hear me talking, won't you come back home? Love me like you did before. Now need I tell you more?
Tears, sad and blue. I shed lonesome tears for you. Yes, you know I cried when you said goodbye.
Old studio was used last in 1969 when Norman moved out of there. This is the small studio. I think I'd call it small because most recording studios were big. But Buddy Holly and the Crickets did all of their hits, most all of their hits, I'd say, like That'll Be the Day and Peggy Sue, Every Day. And when these boys came in, I thought, are these boys musicians? And they looked real gangly to me, and they didn't look like they'd have any a talent at all. When they started playing, well, they showed us different. I don't think there was an actual boss. I really don't. I believe Norman would start it out, and if Buddy would have a suggestion, he would probably try it. He used different microphones. I mean, he would change microphones probably several times. But when we'd start rehearsing the numbers is when he would go around and set up microphones and get the sounds he wanted.
Was he a real perfectionist about it?
Yes, yes. And like I say, he may change microphones several times until he got just the exact sound that he wanted. And but we'd have fun while he's doing all this. And it was when he was ready to get down to business and we got serious. And we have the control room right here. So I guess thinking of the older times, I'm not sure this was here when Buddy was here, but he had a disc cutter here that he did use to cut the records on. And of course he always kept time with things real good with the Western Union clock. So, and his tape recorders were over on that side. There's one or two over there. And this is the original board where many of the Buddy Holly and Cricket hits were done.
Hello.
Did you record it? Hello, hello, hello.
Can you speed the echo up, baby?
Speed the echo up. Hey, can you go pa-pow, 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 again? Yeah, do that right before the first part there. Do it. Okay, let's do it.
New York was the place for record deals, and Norman had contacts there. Through Murray Deutsch of Southern Music, the Crickets were signed by Bob Thiel at Coral Brunswick Records. But he became good friends with both of them.
To visit with Bob Thiel and let him see how happy we are feeling just to be with the Brunswick Record Company. Well, this was Norman's idea. What a place. Well, this was
Norman. I guess Norman was important in that he sort of pulled it all together and made some sense out of it.
He sort of with that nothing went past his head. Norman Petty. He was like the chief.
He was in charge.
He was the cop. He was the policeman, and nobody can talk to anybody unless Norman knew what it was all about. But eventually that changed. But it took
well,
a
we
while.
Had the I don't know whether it was after That'll Be the Day or the second hit or Murray and I were invited to. to Clovis, New Mexico. And I don't know, we were invited just to be there and meet Norman Petty and the family and see everybody. And,
gave us those cowboy hats when we got off the plane.
We got off the plane, they had a band playing. Yeah. It's like the Beatles arriving in Clovis. And then they presented us with two 10-gallon hats. Yeah. And we spent about 3 days there. Yeah. And there again, I mean, Buddy was just a nice guy. He was just a nice kid. He was a gentleman. He really was.
It had to be Norman Petty. Every song had to have. He had to have billing as well as anybody else. Now, I don't say he didn't write the songs, but he had to have his name on everything. He had to own it. He was the headmaster.
Every move that we made in the studio, everything that we did, I felt at that time was made for a good reason, and not necessarily as an ego extension of Norman Petty. I don't really believe, honestly, that I ever pushed what I wanted to do onto Buddy, because not me, not Jerry Allison, not you would be able to convince Buddy Holly to do anything that he, in the end, didn't want to do. He was as stubborn a critter as I've ever met in my life.
This is the building next door to the studio. It was his dad's garage. And he took the top part of it and built this room for an echo chamber. And he had Mr. Holly and Travis and Larry come over and put this tile down. And that was to increase the reverberation. How he got his sound back over there was he put speakers in the place, had microphones in front of them, and whatever he was running through the speaker, if he wanted echo at that time, he would turn that microphone on and it would go back into the studio. One time the boys were recording, and some cricket sound came through. I'm not sure whether they kept hearing the cricket or not, but it came through right at the end of a recording. And, well, after they hit their last chord and the cricket came in, they left it on the record.
We did a lot of different things, like on every day. I played on my knees just when we were sort of working on the song, deciding what order to do it in, to keep it quieter so everybody could hear what Buddy was doing on the guitar. I was just like sort of playing along on my knees, and Norman Petty said, I don't remember exactly how it came about, but he said, let's try that. So he just like mic'd, just playing the knees like that. And on a song called Well Alright, just like all the way through, just played laid the cymbal, I think this very cymbal on the floor, and just played. Well, all right, so I'm being cool. And you know, no other drums on it. And then Party Doll, which had been closed before that, Buddy Knox and the Rhythm Orchids, they used a cardboard box on that. So when we started to do Not Fade Away, we said, hey, that sounded good then, so let's do it again. And I'll show you how it sounds, because I just emptied a box last night. And I'll show you how it sounded like this. Well, all I want was a party doll. Be with me when I'm feeling wild. Be with Not Fade Away, sound like this. Well, I'm gonna tell you how it's gonna be. You're gonna give your love to me.
It was something very different. It was that rockabilly pop. I don't know what the heck it was at that time. It was something that hit us between the eyes. And then I think Bob should pick it up there, because I wasn't in sales. I was just delighted that we had a hit. And then the cockroaches came out of the wall. Everybody wanted it. Everybody wanted him. Everybody wanted his songs. And then, of course, if I'm not mistaken, the next release was Peggy Sue.
That kind of stuff.
And how's that different from other guitarists?
Well, other guitarists will just play, a single string, or, I can't play like Chuck Berry, but, Chuck Berry will play this kind of stuff. And that kind of stuff, just on two strings or something.
You talked about him playing rhythm lead, not conventional lead. And how is Buddy different then?
He played on all the strings, Played a lot of downstrokes too, like everything was hard, like you can do the same thing like down and up, but Buddy played all downstrokes.
That's sort of how Peggy Sue went on the road and for TV, like live performances. And it's a lot different from it. Started out as Cindy Lou, and like a Latin, I think it was maybe a rumba beat, went like. There was an awful lot of Latin things around then, so we finally figured out to do it when we recorded it in the studio with paradiddles, just on one drum. And Norman Petty, the engineer, flipped the sound in and out of the echo chamber and changed the volume, or I think increased the dBs. Anyway, just played it on one drum like this.
Peggy Sue, oh, how my heart yearns for you.
remember we're all in an Irving Fell tour, Show of Stars. And we knew that they were going to join the show. That was a Sunday or something. And they were all down in the basement of this big arena where we were playing, the three of them, and wearing these gray suits, guitar they bought in Texas. They had grown up together. They were like, literally like brothers. They were wonderful, friendly. They were friendly. They were very, very into the, they had even a kind of a Texas language we didn't even understand at that time. A lot of things they would talk about and things. It was really kind of a little alien to Phil and I, you know. Just the way their sense of humor and everything. We became such friends that, over the years, it just became part of our life, the way they were. They were a group, too, which they were self-contained, which Phil and I weren't even at that time. So it was really kind of a camaraderie there, the beginning of rock and roll. When we became friends, we started going shopping together. And Phil and I had, I think, been in New York a couple of times more than Buddy and J.I. and Joe B. had. And so we started all shopping at the same place. And I think if you notice over the pictures, you'll notice some of the clothes was similar, and then it was, everything had a belt in the back and even little hats and long rows of buttons up your coats. And it was called the Ivy League look. It was so much to see, and we hadn't really ever been anywhere, none of us. That was quite a thrill. Go to dinner, we all got into that real quick. And shopping, and things like that. And have a bit of money to spend, and you're in New York City, and in L.A.
Every day it's getting better, getting more cards and getting more letters. Everybody loves to tune our way. Hey, hey, everybody loves to tune our way.
First tour we went on in 30 days we'd play 30 places, and there were 3 days off, I think, for us on the whole, like a 17-week tour. We booked the first 3 weeks were like in theaters, like a week at a time, and then after that was one nighters. And we went to Canada, from Canada to California and back to Canada, and played we only missed like 4 or 5 states on that tour.
You have to figure a bus loaded with, everybody in the top 10. Frankie Lyman, and it was a lot of fun to be around, And they'd sing, make up songs, and, 99 bottles of beer on the wall, stuff like that, and just general kibitzing and a bunch of entertainers. People would be jamming. It just was, I wouldn't take $1 billion for that. Those memories were really sensational. You'd sometimes sleep up in the rack and stuff like that, and sometimes you travel all night, but most of the time you were on the bus, It was fun. It was tiring, but I was, 18 years old, young and healthy, could do it.
Did the older performers tend to look after the new bloods?
Yeah, Laverne Baker was on the tour, and Laverne was almost like when your buttons came off your jacket, you could go to Laverne, get him sewed on, that kind of thing. And it was just good, It was really a lot of fun, it really was.
Tell you how it's gonna be. Bop, 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 bop. Are you gonna give your love to me? Bop, 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 bop. I wanna love you night and day. Bop, 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 bop. You know my love will not fade away. Bop, 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 bop. Oh, well, you know my love will not fade away.
Bop, bop. It was really funny because they actually thought we were a black act when they booked us on the show. And so we were booked with, in the Howard Theater in Washington, D.C., and the Royal in Baltimore, and the Apollo in New York. And it worked out great for us because all the people that were on the shows, that was our kind of music, and we were big fans of theirs. And what we always heard is from listening to the record and also the fact there had been a black Crickets. But we thought, they think that we're black, and we thought, yeah, that's great, because that's what we were trying to sound, was like our black idols, or whatever you'd call them. I mean, we were sort of a novelty, I think. And of course, they'd been, Little Richard had been through Lubbock, and we'd been to his shows at the Cotton Club, standing right in front going, hey, all right, and, hanging out backstage and all that. So we halfway knew them. They sort of remembered us, but they were always real nice to us, and they were marveling that we were into what, I mean, when somebody's a big fan of yours, you can't really be off them. You got to kind of like them a little bit. And But they were always real nice to us.
Did Buddy and Little Richard get on well?
Oh, yeah, they got to be good buddies. I think Little Richard appreciated what Buddy was doing, and he knew Buddy had been a fan of his since Tutti Frutti, which I guess was his first record.
We might hear them talking among themselves, you know, they'd say, it's just another one record act, you know. They'll have one record and they'll be down the tube like so many have been. But then a lot of them were sincere, and as you asked, they did try to help us, you know.
Don and I didn't have a band. We didn't travel with a band and all, and the Crickets were on the show. Jerry Lee was on the show. And Don and I were headlining. The second half consisted of the Crickets opening, the second half, Jerry Lee, and then Don and I. Well, Don and I got down there, and the booker had supplied us with three high school boys that couldn't play. You know, so in essence, like, you really had a band that you couldn't go on with. So we were stuck, and we opened up that night. And Buddy volunteered to play for us. And it was one of the best, of course, Jerry Lee. Without Buddy, I don't know if we could have followed Jerry Lee at the time, because Buddy had them really worked over, and, you know, they were really on their feet. And then Jerry Lee came out and do his great act. But only by the grace of God and Buddy Holly and the Crickets did Don and I manage to pull it off. But when Buddy Holly came back and played for us and we did our stuff, it was just pandemonium. All of my sisters, you don't know what you've been. I miss you, no boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you was a miss for me. All of my life I've been waiting, and I'd never be no hesitating, no boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you was a miss for me. Stars appear and the shadows are falling. You can hear my heart calling. A little bit of love, it makes everything right. I'm gonna see my baby tonight. All of my love, all of my kissing. You don't know what you've been. I'm missing, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. Oh! Listen, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. All my life I've been waiting, and I'll be no hesitating, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that you were meant for me. Stars appear and the shadows are falling. You can hear my heart calling. A little bit of love, it makes everything right. I'm gonna see my baby tonight. All of my love, all of my kissing. You don't know just what you've been. I'm missing, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy. I thought the world could say that you were meant for me.
I remember one time Buddy was going, they had these things in Lubbock they call fair tours. That, like, they get a band, local band in Lubbock, and they go around to small towns around Lubbock, and they call it the fair tour because they were promoting the South Plains Fair. And Sonny and Buddy and Don Yes, I believe, were on this deal. And Buddy got stopped on the like for speeding in the car on the way to, like, to start the tour or something. And the policeman said, "Hey, you know, got on his face." He said, "Hey, man. You know, like, I'm gonna go do a fair tour to promote this fair for this county, and you know, and you're stopping me and you're gonna give me a ticket, charge me money when I'm hurrying down to get to this deal to do something good for the state and the county, and I'm just doing good." And you know, you had that kind of attitude, like, "Hey, what are you talking about? Fooling with me? Because I'm not hurting anybody." And I mean, he was real confident. If the police would stop most folks like me, I'd say, "Sorry, sir, I didn't mean to be speeding." You know.
He was reserved in ways, but he could also really be fun, you know. He'd really get down. He'd go into a restaurant and the next thing you knew, you'd be sitting around the table tuning the glasses and pouring water and trying to play a tune. And, you know, you go to a movie, and I remember one movie we saw, that thing, Wuthering Heights, you know, with Laurence Olivier and Merle Oberon, and there's one real silly line in that movie where she says something that, like, "If you come over to my house, I'll let you hold my hand beneath my fan." And Buddy said, "Have mercy," throughout the whole movie theater. It just roared, you know. Sometimes he could really embarrass you, you know.
Oh, he'll remember when he got his meerschaum pipe. Have you ever seen pipe? I never had heard of one either. And he came backstage and he was holding it by the little black part, and this big white pipe was sticking out here, curved and everything. And I says, "What?" They says, "It's a meerschaum." He says, "You can't touch it with your hand." He says, "Gets grease on it." He says, "And you got it, turns the bowl." So he was walking around with his pipe. He was meticulous like that, and he had a little case he put it in and everything.
When Buddy bought something, he bought the best there was to get. Like when he bought his first Fender Stratocaster, you know, I think that was the first one in Lubbock, Texas, and I couldn't believe that was a guitar. That was the first solid body guitar I'd ever seen. And, you know, with a gear shift on it, man, you know, you can change tones with that. And I was very impressed with it. And I think a lot of other people were too. And after we did our first tour in Europe, seems like everybody wanted to talk to Buddy about his guitar.
Up to heaven, when you took me in your arms, I was dazzled by your kisses, blinded by your charms. I was lost,
I was lost
in a fool's paradise,
fool's paradise,
good and lost,
good and lost
in a fool's paradise. When you told me that you loved me, heart to you, and I wondered if there could be any truth in love so new. I was lost,
I was lost
in a fool's paradise,
fool's paradise,
good and lost,
good and lost
in a fool's paradise.
I believe this is Heathrow. It says London Airport. Would that be, that probably be what it is then? This is part of the tour. We were on a three-week tour with the band and comedians and singers. It was really a lot of fun. This is Cambridge. And old Jerry turned around real quick. I don't know who's pulling the shirt there. That's Buddy and Joe B. And there was Wally. He was our manager, road manager. And I'm standing there with Wally. I don't believe that Jerry and Joe B and Buddy really saw much of the country. Seems like they stayed up all night and they slept on the bus all the way. They were just piled all over each other in the bus. I believe this is Salisbury, the old George Hotel. It was really neat. The ladies fixed us hot chocolate at night. We sat in front of the fireplace.
The rock and roll tours here had like 20, around 20 acts on them. And I mean, all rock and rollers, everybody had a hit record or two hit records or whatever. And then we went to England and there was like a juggling act. And Des O'Connor was the announcer and a comedian. And the Tanner Sisters. And there was the band Ronnie Keane. It was like a 14-piece band. And anyway, we were the only rock and rollers on the whole deal. Well, Buddy always jumped around a lot and acted silly, and Joe B would lay on his back and play the bass, and Holly would get down singing Joe B's bass mic, and I mean, we just act as crazy as possible. You know, really rock and roll it. Well, the whole thing was just really fun, because it's like going to England is such a change. And we were accepted real well. I think Bill Haley had been there before us, but other than that, there hadn't been any rock and roll in England. And everybody was marveling. We thought, well, aren't we the ones?
Baby, that someday will come.
That was the first record we ever made with the Beatles in a little studio in Liverpool. We just went up there one day and made this little shellac record. I think we were hearing all the kind of stuff like the sort of Stargazers, you know, those kind of vocal groups. And there was people like Guy Mitchell, you know, sort of, and Tommy Steele. And Lonnie Donegan was the big sort of starter over here, you know, for a lot of the English people. But then there started to come in these, like, very exciting records just over the radio. And you didn't really know, you know, like now there's an expression, where it's coming from. Then you didn't know where that kind of thing was coming from. That'll Be the Day, for instance, like a very exciting record. You didn't know if they were black, white. It didn't really matter. Just a very sort of electric sound on the radio. And you just got intrigued by these things, I think, you know, this kind of mystic image coming over the radio of these sort of strange new music. I mean, obviously, like all these years later, it's difficult to just say what it was about a person. But then I think you were looking at all the stars like Elvis and over in England, Cliff Richard and stuff, and they were all they're really good-looking fellas, you know. And then Buddy came along, and he was a fellow with glasses. And you'd never really seen anyone with glasses. You know, it always seemed that anyone who had glasses couldn't make it as a singer or stuff, or at least they had to take their glasses off and have contacts in or something. But suddenly this singer appeared, you know, these big horn-rimmed specs, and we were getting ready to start the Beatles and thinking of making a group. So John Lennon, who normally wore the horn-rimmed specs but always took them off on stage, he was now able to put them on and see the world, you know. The only thing I remember was Sunday night at the Palladium. We used to have a big variety show. And Buddy was on that once, and that was the big occasion to watch his fingers, to see what guitar he had, and to see if he played the chords right, and to see how he did that solo in Peggy Sue, and see whether he used a capo or not. You know, all the various technical things, that was where you got your info.
That's the beauty of Buddy's thing for me, is the self-containedness of it all. He didn't need anybody else, he didn't need to worry about, you know, songs. He could just put it all together, he had a great band. Yeah. I mean, God knows how he got it together, but he was the first one to do it. I mean, until the Beatles turned up, probably, and Bob Dylan, who strengthened very much that thing of writing your own material, and nobody else, you know, was in that position. Elvis hardly wrote a song in his life. Jerry Lee Lewis has written one. All the other guys didn't do it, you know, and it was in that respect, Buddy was, you know, streets ahead of his time. Yeah. And it wasn't until after he was well dead and buried that other people started to manage to get it together in that way, you know, not just to play together and do other people's songs, but to make a totally self-contained unit out of a band, you know. It's not easy, believe me. I'm well aware that I've lifted a few of his licks on solos here and there, especially on the road, you know. That's the other great thing about Buddy, it was a working music, you know, it worked on stage. You could do it in the studio and you could do it on stage, you know, without any extra effort. It worked, you know. It was a beautiful piece of precision work, you know, performance, whatever, writing, the whole thing was, he had it all. What can you say, lucky devil?
I want to tell you how it's gonna be. You're gonna give your love to me.
Maybe it was the fact of doing Buddy's song that also gave us that extra provocation to start writing our own stuff, you know, because we'd done our gig You know, we'd recorded it and it was great and everybody was successful. And, well, now you're a star, now what's next? And I think Buddy's inspiration, that point of view, in that he wrote his own songs, which obviously influenced the Beatles incredibly. Yeah. And slowly dawned on us that, you know, it would be great if one of us could write some songs, two of us would be fantastic. And I think maybe doing Buddy's songs sort of maybe promoted and got us together to start trying to write songs.
We used to write songs like Buddy. The very first songs that John and I wrote, we used to sag off school and go to my house and sit down with guitars and... I was a cuckoo, you was a you know, and all that. We just, how can you, how does he do it, you know? I love it, you know, we just try that for hours and hours. And eventually, out of it, we got a couple of little songs, you know, we got Love Me Do, which was the first Beatle record. Love Me Do. It's sort of the same, you know, I love you. It's like the same two, three chords job, you know. It wasn't quite as bad as that. But, you know, it all came out of this idea of three chords, a group, standing up there, playing your instruments while you do, you can see echoes of Buddy Holly and the Crickets in the Beatles.
One and only Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly. Hey, Buddy.
How are you, Alan?
How are you?
Well, we haven't been working all summer, Alan. We've just been kind of loafing and taking it easy and running around some, enjoying the what we hadn't enjoyed for the whole year previous, you know, all the work going on.
Oh, boy, you worked hard that year, Buddy.
So we're getting ready to start in some new work now.
You going on tour again?
And I think so, uh-huh.
Buddy, we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of flying.
Yeah, we sure did. You know, Joe, I was just in the town the other day in Cincinnati. You remember when we landed there and the helicopter had crashed that day that we got in there?
That's right. Buddy, we played, I think we rode every kind of airplane there was imagined.
We sure did.
Those DC-3s were really something.
With the...
Oh, boy. Without the seatbelts, we'd have been right through the top, that's sure. For sure. Well, we had a lot of fun together, and Buddy, let's get together soon, and thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Alan. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you.
We'd been riding our motorcycles when we were sitting around on a curb on 6th Street in Lubbock, Texas. And we'd had an offer come in for a tour. And I was saying, hey, buddy, what? You know, I was trying to talk him into doing the tour. And he said, well, let's take some time off and enjoy ourselves. And I said, no, I don't know. You know, we may not, you know, what if records quit selling? We can't make this much money in a year or two. We better do this tour now instead of waiting, you know, and, you know, maybe later on we can't do it. And he said, well, what are you wanting to buy a Cadillac or something you don't have? And I said, well, no, not really. And he said, man, if you want a Cadillac, I'll buy you a Cadillac. I said, no, that's not it. He said, well, man, what if you got killed tomorrow, you know? And you didn't have any time to enjoy the money we've already made. What about that? You know, if we just work all the time and don't enjoy ourselves. And I said, you're right, you know? Like, that's exactly right. Forget that tour, let's take some time off and ride our motorcycles and fool around. We just got married and all that. So, we, you know, I just shut up. I mean, that was a whole new thought for me. Like, hey, what if you did get killed tomorrow?
Heartbeat, why do you miss when my baby kisses me? Heartbeat, why does a love kiss stay in my memory?
Peggy Sue and I got married in June, like June 22nd. So Peggy Sue and I sort of waited to go on our honeymoon until Buddy and Maria Elena got married. Then we all went to Mexico together, went to Acapulco. And it sort of, it was uncomfortable, the whole sort of thing was. And all of a sudden then it wasn't like Joe B and Buddy and I hanging out. It was like all of a sudden, I wanted to hang out with Peggy Sue, and Buddy wanted to hang out with Maria Lane, and it was weird. We couldn't talk to each other as much as we had before. And then the next tour we went on after that, which was the last tour we went on, Peggy Sue stayed home, and Joe B and I took a station wagon, and Buddy, he and Maria Lane took a car, so we weren't like, it wasn't the friendship deal like it had been, so it got weird.
I like to think of it not necessarily as breaking up. The Crickets and Buddy Holly quit performing together. Buddy had married and had aspirations of going on to bigger and better things, I'm sure, and I think he might possibly have been influenced by his wife. He wanted to get away from the manager that we were with at the time, and wanted to go to New York, try new things, orchestration-wise and whatever. And like I said before, Buddy was headstrong. You know, when he had his mind made up to do something, he did it. So he just said, guys, I'm going to move to New York where I can be close to the record companies, the publishers, and this and that. And I hope you guys will go along. Of course, J.I. and I had decided we wanted to stay back where we grew up and not get involved in the big business end of it.
Then we flew home, then went over to Clovis, and Norman Petty said, hey, if you guys move to New York, you're gonna be sorry. And we'd already made up our mind, we're all gonna move to New York. And Norman Petty talked us out of it, said, you guys stay here, and you'll be better off. And we didn't really wanna move to New York anyway. So, I mean, I always said, well, we wanted to stay in Texas, and Buddy wanted to move to New York, but that wasn't the deal. I mean, because we wanted to be a group, but Norman Petty, the fact is, talked us out of it. I mean, the straight deal. He said, hey, if you move to New York, I got control now, because he did. He had control of all the money. And he said, if you move to New York, then no telling what'll happen.
Little things you say and do make me want to be with you. Rain on, it's a crazy feeling, and
Buddy and Maria Elena moved to an apartment on 9th Street and 5th Avenue in New York's Greenwich Village. Maria Elena encouraged her husband to have new publicity pictures taken with Bruno, New York's best-known show business photographer, and to get involved in the many opportunities the big city had to offer. In New York, Buddy did get involved in drama, record production, and of course, the famous string sessions. In October 1958, he recorded 4 songs in New York's Pythian Temple. The producer was Dick Jacobs.
I remember the session was scheduled for 8 o'clock at Pythian Temple. And at about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, I look at my door and in rushes Buddy Holly, and he's carrying his guitar, and he says to me, Dick, 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 he says, I hate to do this to you, he says, but Paul Anka just wrote a new song and he gave it to me as an exclusive. And he says, we have to do it on the session tonight. I says, Buddy, I says, we got 3 hours before the session, we got to write it in the rain. He says, we got to do it. I says, okay, you want to do the song? We're going to do the song. And he didn't even have a lead sheet with him at the time. And he took his guitar out and I got my score paper out. I called my copyist to come to the office right away. Which he did, and Buddy sang me the melody and the lyrics of It Doesn't Matter Anymore. I guess everybody knew we had a hit coming right out because the song was great. I guess the arrangement was too, and Buddy was absolutely superb, and we came out with a very, very fine record.
There you go, baby, here am I, will you
left me here so I could sit and cry. Well, golly gee, what have you done to me? Well, I guess it doesn't matter anymore. Do you remember, baby, last September, how you held me tight each and every night? Well, whoops-a-daisy, how you drove me crazy, but I guess it doesn't matter anymore.
The Christmas before he got killed, he brought her here for Christmas. They brought a bunch of
here also,
a bunch of presents. We had a big Christmas, and he was really starting to feel some money then, you know. And we had always been pretty well behind the eight ball financially, and so they brought us some great gifts and everything. And the fact is, when we went fishing, Buddy would take us in a big place and buy everything that we needed to fish with, you know, all the equipment. And here we'd go, me and him, Daddy and Travis and two or three other guys, our cousin Sam. We had some good times, I tell you. It just didn't last long enough.
So much admiration for him and so much, so proud of him, you know. And also proud of the small part that we have had in shaping his life and career. And the only tragedy was him leaving this life so young. And that's something we all have to face.
The last time I saw Buddy, and we had a long time to visit, was he was up in Eddie Cochran's room, you know, and they called, and I came over. We went back to his place, and he played me all of his cuts. He had a professional machine in his house, in the middle of his living room it was, and we sat there and listened to about six cuts. Sounded great to me, you know, and he was at that time looking to get a hit, and he told me that he was going to stay off the road till he got a hit. But I think some of his circumstances, financially, with problems he was having, and maybe with Petty and all of them, forced him to get out on the road.
Is that why he went on the last tour, do you think?
That's what I suspect, because if I go with just what I know, a Buddy, the last time I saw Buddy was at a lawyer's office. We were coming out as he was coming in, and he was trying to resolve this problem of money that he thought himself owed. And I think if he'd had that money, he would have waited until one of his songs had gone top 10.
Hearts that are broken and love that's untrue, these go with learning the game. When you love her and she doesn't love you, you're only learning the game. When she says that you're the only one she'll ever love, then you find that you are not the one she's thinking of. Feeling so sad and you're all alone and blue, that's when you're learning the game.
It's cold. It's really cold. We were out 12 days before they got killed, and we had eight different buses in that 12-day period. One night, we was just driving down the road, and the bus just froze up. I mean, just literally stopped. We was going up this hill, and it was so cold outside. The bus froze, so we were left sitting in the middle of the road on this bus with no heat. So we were burning papers in the aisle, and our drummer got his feet frostbite in his feet just sitting on the bus. So we had to leave him there. I think it's Green Bay, Wisconsin, somewhere in that area. We left him in a hospital. So he was in the hospital when the guys got killed. We played a job that night. Of course, we didn't have a drummer, and Richie Valens played drums with us. One of the Belmonts played drums when Richie was on. Buddy played drums behind somebody. You know, he'd jump out there and play drums. But anyhow, he wanted to fly because we'd been out 12 days. We didn't get our laundry done, and like I said, it had been really cold on those buses. So he chartered this plane to take three people. Me and him and Waylon was going to fly. Well, the big bopper had kind of got the flu that afternoon, so he wanted to go ahead and get in early the next day and get him a shot at a doctor. So sometime that night, Waylon gave up his seat to the bopper. And when I went back in, Richie was in there signing autographs. And he said, "You going to let me fly a guy?" And I said, "No." And he says, "Come on." He says, "Flip." He had a half a dollar. He says, I flipped the coin and said, heads I go and tails you go. So he flipped the coin. I said, okay, if you want to go that bad. And he had never flown on a small plane before in his life, which is kind of ironic, you know. But I don't know why I did it, because all night long he had asked me to go, and I said no. But for some reason, I said, go ahead, you know, if you want to go that bad. Well, he won the toss, so I walked back out. He got in the station wagon. I walked back to the station wagon. I guess I was probably the last one to talk to Buddy, because I said, Buddy, I got a registered letter to post office my mother sent to Fargo. Would you pick it up for me? And he said, yeah. He said, I need some identification. Let me have your driver's license. So I said, here, take my wallet. So he just stuck my wallet in his pocket, you know. So when the plane was found the next morning, they found four bodies and five identifications. So the first news that went out, I was listed as one of the dead because they found my ID, see?
My sister called me and told me about it. Woke me up, as a matter of fact. It was unbelievable, of course, to me, and I wouldn't accept it until I went down and got a newspaper. And, of course, basically all I had to do was turn on the radio. And it still took me a long time to accept the fact. In fact, probably a couple of years. Because I kept thinking it was maybe a publicity stunt, or Buddy's not really gone. Because I didn't see him, you know. It was a closed casket funeral. And I just wouldn't accept the reality. Of course, I guess it's that way with any time someone loses a relative or someone as close to them as Buddy was to me, or I should say as Buddy and I were. And I just didn't want to accept it. I just knew one day he's going to be walking down the street, you know, and I'll see him.
Oh, I know my dreams cannot come true. All those precious things we shared together. Time goes by, I'll still remember you, and that makes it tough, oh so tough,
when you tell me you don't love me.
That makes it tough, oh, so tough.
Mm-hmm. Oh, oh.
When you say you don't care for me no more.
Had an influence on everybody that's playing now, that's just come out as well, because what they've listened to is, it's been handed on, you know. His Buddy was one of the, he was in the union, you know. He was one of the troubadours, you just pass it on, you know. And he passed it on via the Beatles, via us. Everything he did is, I mean, you still hear it on the radio today, a brand new release, but you hear Buddy Holly in there. You can, you know, he's in everybody. How much, and there is another thing, you know, but this is not bad from a guy from Lubbock, right?
Hold me close and tell me how you feel. Tell me love is real. Words of love you
whisper soft and true, darling, I love you.
Can't get on it, Norm. The page just blurs. Can't even see the word looking right at him. I've gone through it so many times, it's just going, you know, it's a circle, and the circle tightens up and catches up with it, and another time comes before it's time to sing this one. That's what's getting me so bad, is the concentration.
Crap time.
We're making the crap out, I'll just tell you for sure. Let's go.
Love like yours will surely come my way.